Hello friends, my name is JJ, and allow me to share with you a fun little observation about the way that this whole COVID-19 thing is affecting life here in Canada. As I'm sure you know, whenever you go out anywhere these days, you will find lots of little bossy signs telling you to not get too close to other people. And how not close, you ask? Well, where I live, if the sign is made by the government, it will tell you to stay 2 meters apart. But if the sign is made by a private business, like say in the mall or something, it will tell you to stay 6 feet apart. I like this because it is such a clear example of the confused spectacle that is Canada's kinda, sorta, half-hearted embrace of the metric system, 1970 to present. Now, the metric system, or SI system, as it is often called these days, is of course a system of measurement that was made up by the French in the aftermath of the French Revolution. From the very beginning, it claimed to be a measurement system that was hyper-rational and culturally neutral, and thus universally applicable. And the pitch worked, and during the 19th century, it was gradually embraced by most European nations and the European empires. The European powers liked the metric system because it was seen as a helpful tool to facilitate global trade and commerce. And as the years went on, the precise rules of the metric system were hashed out in numerous international conventions and treaties and institutions. However, it is important to note that despite the metric system's pretenses of being the world's most rational, universal system for measuring things, the metric system was never based around perfectly neutral standards plucked from thin air, because that would be impossible. We humans cannot conceptualize an abstract concept like weight or distance without it being in relation to something in our physical world. And accordingly, in its early days, the metric system was very much calibrated around various real-world physical objects. The kilogram, for instance, which is one of the most important base units of the metric system, was originally calibrated around the weight of a certain size container of ice water, then a container of slightly warmer water, and then a cylinder of pure platinum they kept in a vault in Paris, which was later replaced by a tiny cylinder of platinum alloy. The meter, meanwhile, the system's other most important base unit, was originally said to be the length of 1/10 millionth of the distance from the equator to the North Pole, which was then replaced by the length of this iron bar, which was also kept in a vault in Paris. It was not until 2018, in fact, that the metric system's governing body fully abandoned the practice of using physical objects as reference and instead switched to these complex mathematical formulas based on Planck's constant of quantum mechanics and the speed of light. But anyway, back in the 19th century, one very important European superpower refused to go along with the metric craze: Great Britain. Instead, the Brits just decided to officialize some of their British units of measurement, in the same way that the metric people were doing. So in 1824, the British base unit of length, the yard, was tied to the length of this bronze bar, while the British base unit of weight, the pound, was tied to the weight of this little platinum knob. The recently independent former British colony, known as the United States of America, meanwhile, did its best to import the British rules into their new country. The Americans were still pretty deferential to English authority on a lot of things in those days. In 1836, the Americans made replicas of the British base units in order to ensure that their measurements would remain in sync with those of the motherland, although at the same time they did reject some of the more radical changes that the British were trying to sneak in, such as redefining the size of a gallon and a bushel, which is why to this day the Brits and Americans still disagree as to what is the correct size of these rather obscure units of measurement. Now, this being the state of the world in the 19th century, it was always pretty obvious which side lowly Canada was going to take. Canada was a colony of the British Empire that was deeply culturally and economically linked to the United States, so using the Anglo-American measurement system, which we now often call the imperial system, made the most sense. In case you are wondering, by the way, Canada went with the British gallon rather than the American one, which was a long-standing source of confusion for any American or Canadian who tried to buy gas after crossing the border. So anyway, that was the status quo for like 100 years or something. But then, in the mid-20th century, there was suddenly this great fad of any country that had not yet adopted the metric system to finally get a rune to doing so. The fad known as the metrication movement. And the pressure worked, and in the early 1970s, Canada, Britain, and the United States all announced to the world that they were officially going metric. And in the decades that followed, all three countries would proceed to break that promise in various brazen ways. I think Americans are sometimes a little bit unaware of this fact, because of course the conventional narrative these days is that everywhere is metric except America, and aren't Americans big dumb hicks for being so backwards and yada yada. But the fact remains that the two countries that are most culturally and historically linked to the United States are also fairly big flops as far as the mid-20th century metrication project went. And this matters because I think it gets at something fundamental about the limitations of making sweeping societal changes in a modern pluralistic democracy, as opposed to just some narrow stereotype about Americans. Now that said, America's failure to metricate is undeniably the most dramatic of the three, whereas Britain and Canada have failed in more complex and nuanced ways. I like this summary I found on this American pro-metric blog called Metric Maven. Here is how he describes his theory of the other two countries.
I began to see both Canada and the UK as inverse metric M&Ms. Canada has a thin outer metric coating and looks metric on first glance, but hidden inside its slim shell is an unappetizing center of ye olde English / imperial usage. England's M&M outer shell makes it look like an imperial nation. Roadways have miles. Pints are sold in pubs. Metric martyrs are in the news. But when you get past the outer shell, the interior of the English M&M is all metric.
I will leave it to my British viewers to tell me how accurate that summary of their country is. I do know that in 2007, the European Union officially gave up on trying to make Britain go full metric, and now that they're out of the EU, I guess it will never happen. But on the other hand, as the metric maven says, the system has almost certainly permeated much deeper there than it has in Canada or the US. I will also note that this whole idea of any country not using the metric system in this day and age is a bit of a misnomer. Even in supposedly non-metric countries, the metric system is so deeply integrated into global scientific research and technological standards that it's basically impossible to avoid. And it's likewise important to note that neither Britain nor America was ever really that opposed to the metric system per se. In the late 19th century, both countries signed the so-called Treaty of the Meter that recognizes the authority of the International Bureau of Weights and Measures, which is the body that sets the rules of the metric system. And this became uniquely relevant in 1959 when the Brits and Americans officially ditched their object-based standards for defining their units of length and weight, and instead tied their official definition of pound and yard and all the rest of it to a formula of metric conversion. So living in a non-metric country these days merely means living in a country where most people do not use explicitly metric units for day-to-day purposes. And on that note, let us talk about Canada. The Canadian government during the 1970s, under the kinetic leadership of Prime Minister Pierre Elliott Trudeau, was very committed to the goal of metrication, but was also aware that changing the country's system of weights and measures this late in the game was not broadly popular with the Canadian public. As a result, the rollout was very slow, a lot of exceptions were made, and enforcement was pretty lax. And then when the Conservative Party was elected in 1984, things slowed down even more, and by the 1990s, the issue had long ceased to be anyone's priority. As a result, today Canadian metrication is this weird sort of half-finished project, like a house that someone started building and just kind of walked away from. As it stands, the most successful examples of Canadian metrication are all the result of heavy-handed government initiatives in the early 1970s that sought to target the biggest fish first. And what were the biggest fish in 1970s Canada? Cars. All Canadian road signs and car speedometers have been legally required to display kilometers since 1977, and gasoline has been required to be sold in liters rather than British gallons since 1979. Temperature forecasts on television and in the newspaper have also gone 100% metric in Canada. I remember when I was growing up, it would be common to see them post the Celsius and Fahrenheit numbers side by side, but no one really seems to do that anymore. If you live in a new house, the thermostats will all be in metric, although thermometers are often sold with both sets of numbers. But beyond these things, which cannot be avoided because the government will not let you, efforts to bring the metric system into broader realms of Canadian life have been pretty solidly rejected by the Canadian public. For starters, Canadians never ever measure anything that has to do with their personal lives using the metric system. If you load up your Canadian dating app and are like, "Hey baby, how tall are you?" No one is ever gonna say, "Oh, I'm 1.4327 meters or whatever. They're always gonna say, "I'm 5'6". And no Canadian ever says, "Oh, I need to lose 2 kilograms for swimsuit season." Body weight is always measured in pounds. And when it comes to things like waist size, nail length, or bicep circumference, basically any body part you want to measure, Canadians will do it in inches. Accordingly, this means things like pants and shoes in Canada are all sold using inch-based sizes as well. Meanwhile, everybody thinks of the size of their own house in terms of square feet, and larger properties in terms of acres. It would certainly be weird to see a Canadian realtor using any other kind of measurement. For example, you can see that this charming 2-bedroom number in Vancouver is listed at 1,215 square feet, which I think we can all agree is what any sensible person would expect to get for $3 million. Because Canadian homes are conceptualized in this way, the Canadian construction industry still uses imperial units when building and measuring things. And this in turn means that basically anything that is remotely construction industry adjacent, from nails and drill bits to wooden planks and pipes, are all sized in imperial units as well. Canadian measuring tapes, like this one, will often only have inches and feet on them, because those are the only units that anyone who needs a measuring tape will want. Canadian rulers, meanwhile, are a bit weird. This particular one only has inches on it, but they often have inches and centimeters, because they're often bought by school children, and learning about centimeters is considered an important way to help learn the metric system. I think there's this general idea among pro-metric people in Canada that because centimeters are kind of like inches, they're one of the most important things to master. But when I was in Japan, I learned that in properly metric countries, their rulers often just have millimeters, and millimeters are actually the more mainstream thing to use where we in imperial countries would use inches. Paper in Japan, for instance, was always measured and sold in millimeters, which resulted in nice whole numbers rather than awkward centimeter fractions. In any case, Canadian paper is always measured and sold in inches, along with things like photographs and envelopes. I see on the Canadian Post Office's website, they post their envelope sizes in both units. As if any Canadian has ever said, "Oh yeah, give me a package of 22.9s by 30.5s. Which brings us to the issue of labeling. You see, Canadian packaging laws passed in the 1970s require companies to post product dimensions using metric units on their labels. But since we still have freedom of speech in this country, there is nothing to stop the companies from also posting their product sizes in imperial units, you know, just to help the consumer make a more informed choice or whatever. And so this is what all of the companies do. In fact, half the time when you see a package in Canada, the imperial size will be written in a bigger or bolder font than the metric one. It is a tacit concession that most Canadian shoppers do not think of the stuff that they're buying, be it a garden hose, medical tape, or a storage tub, in terms of metric units. Now, the food situation is, shall we say, a bit more schizophrenic. When you buy a Canadian cookbook, such as this one, given to me by award-winning Vancouver seafood chef Ned Bell, all of the ingredients will be listed in imperial units. For example, 3 pounds live clams, 1 pound dried spaghetti, 1/2 cup of extra virgin olive oil, 3 tablespoons unsalted butter. But then when you show up at the grocery store, packaged food is one of the few things that does not list its unit size in imperial. Although for some common cooking ingredients, they will post these helpful little conversion diagrams. I think that the logic of the food companies is that in most cases, the big fat Canadians do not want to know the exact quantity of how much food they're wolfing down. And that if anything, they might be less inclined to buy, say, this 455 gram Hungry Man dinner if they knew it contained over a pound of processed animal fat. But still, it can make ingredient shopping difficult. Now, bulk food is another story. Fruits, vegetables, raw meats, nuts. You better believe that stuff's sold in Imperial. And then when you finally get home to make your dinner, you will naturally use Fahrenheit degrees for your cooking temperatures because that is what all Canadian stoves are set to. So anyway, when it comes to units of measurement, Canada is hardly a stellar example of metrication. But on the other hand, we are not exactly a pure imperial nation either. Canadians don't universally use any one system, but rather switch between the two depending on the context. And while in general, the masses are pretty uniform in their understanding of which system should be used in which context, there are still a few realms of debate. The Angus Reid Polling Company actually did a poll of this a few years back, and they found that the realm where there is the most controversy is household fluids, like soap and shampoo. The majority of Canadians claim to think about this stuff in terms of metric, but a sizable minority still claims to prefer imperial. Now you might be thinking, oh man, what an ungodly mess those Canadians have made for themselves with their crazy hybrid system. Their lives must be agony. But here's the thing, in that same Angus Reid poll, they actually found that a majority of Canadians were cool with the status quo. There was little appetite for either going full metric or going back to full imperial, which in turn exposes the big fundamental truth when it comes to systems of measurement. Once people have one, they never want to change it. It doesn't matter if it's arbitrary or irrational or whatever, because on some level, all systems of measurement are. No, what matters to most people is just whether it is familiar, widely used, and well understood. A universal truth in this life is that it is very difficult to use rational arguments to persuade people to stop doing something that they never started doing for rational reasons in the first place. This was the big problem with metrication arguments in the 1970s, as well as today. The pro-metric people attempted to use this hyper-rationalistic logic about how the metric system made more sense or whatever. But that's a bit like saying we should all learn to speak Korean or Esperanto because those languages have more intuitive rules of grammar. It is a completely unpersuasive argument because it doesn't engage with the logic that is actually justifying the status quo. And this is why I think that the stories of the failure of metrication in Canada, the US, and Britain are so important. They tell a very useful lesson, not just about the metric system in particular, but social change more broadly. And on that note, I would really love to hear from some of my international viewers, because I strongly suspect that Canada, the UK, and the US are not the only countries that have had their challenges with metrication. I mean, even in Japan, which, like I said, is a far more metricified country than Canada, I noticed that they would still sometimes use these old-fashioned Japanese measurement units to describe things like the size of a house or a field or stuff like that. So let me know in the comments. Do not forget to give this video a like, and I will see you all next week.